were in the previous lecture. So we are going to use wavelet construction to represent our geometrical approach to function theory, and to this end we will use representation which obtained by induction procedure when we are starting from the character of certain subgroup and then expand it to the representation of entire group. And subgroups which we are considering are our old friends A and K, one-dimensional continuous subgroup of SL2R, and we are making an extension to entire group SL2R. When we tried the first approach, when we considered characters of this one-dimensional subgroup in straightforward way using simple algebra and some algebraic manipulation, and what appears here looks satisfactory in elliptic and hyperbolic case when we use complex and double numbers, but with dual numbers there is a certain degeneracy, and if we consider what is unit circle in the case and unit disk in elliptic and hyperbolic case, then it's meet our expectation, it is circle in usual sense or some region bounded by hyperbolas in hyperbolic case. However, in parabolic situation, we got the strip, which is rather boring, and nothing really remind us about the corresponding parabolic situation. Let's nevertheless sum up our consideration for the wet algebraic approach. So here is the table with three possibilities which we have, elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic, and corresponding imaginary units, which square to minus 1, 0, and 1. Then there is corresponding complex numbers, which we there is some software update here. Let me check if I may. Okay, so it's new version of PD Acrobat Reader, and I don't know how to make here selection. okay, so we build here the complex or hypercomplex number using real and imaginary part and corresponding hypercomplex unit. Conjugation, the third line of this table, is built according to the standard rule. We keep the sign of and value of the real part and change the sign of the imaginary part. Then exponent of hypercomplex unit is calculated based on algebraic expansion into Taylor series, and it became linear function for parabolic situation. When we introduce the modulus as the product of the complex number with its complex conjugated, so again it's x square plus y square in elliptic case, x square minus y square in the hyperbolic case, and just x square without any trace of y in the parabolic situation. Argument is taken using corresponding inverse tangent function, and for the parabolic case it's again just linear function, and then description of corresponding areas which look like candidates to be unit disk. So let us remind what when we studied geometry we was able to resolve as a situation similar appearance in the framework of geometry. So initially we had again the parabolic unit circle as such a strip. And then we was able to consider certain Kelly transform which produce a parabolic unit disk shaped with parabolas and corresponding transformation of this parabolic unit disk which will be which can be treated as parabolic rotations. So we really want to employ that more geometrical picture for construction of our representations. And we start from the scratch, considering the earlier identity. And this time we will realize imaginary units I, epsilon, and j, not as an abstract quantity with certain algebraic properties, but as explicit matrices. So if we assign matrices as in line with equation 4, then we get such property as we desire, what I squared will be minus identity matrix, epsilon square will be zero matrix, and J square will be identity matrix. And then we may find earlier identity through the exponentiation of these matrices multiplied by T. Here, if we do exponent Taylor expansion for these matrices, we again obtain matrices where the corresponding cosine sine function or hyperbolic cosine and sine function appear in certain position of these 2 × 2 matrices. So that will be the matrix form of the Euler identity. So it's exactly just algebraic background here, exactly the same as with Euler identity, classical one. And if we apply exponentiation procedure to the matrix which represent epsilon, then we will obtain a matrix which is not as symmetric as in equation 5. That matrix in equation 6 is lower triangular matrices, or again we may consider upper triangular matrices and get a similar expression. Now we use the Kelly transform which was studied in geometry part of the course, and in the and it was explained what Kelly transform actually help us to diagonalize the corresponding subgroup. So elliptic Kelly transform diagonalizes the subgroup K, compact subgroup, matrices of the form cosine T minus sine T, sine T and cosine T with Kelly transform is in identity 7, we obtain a diagonal matrix. Similarly, matrices from hyperbolic Euler identity, this is matrices hyperbolic cosine, hyperbolic sine, hyperbolic sine, hyperbolic cosine in equation 8 by the hyperbolic Kelly transform, and these matrices form the subgroup A. Then for this subgroup A, we apply hyperbolic Kelly transform and again get diagonalization which produce that rotations in the hyperbolic case. Similarly, we may apply the Kelly transform of parabolic type, and in this case we do not get exactly a diagonal matrix. Nevertheless, it's still a matrix which somehow may be treated in as the closest possible to diagonal one for the matrices from subgroup N. So that upper triangular matrix in equation 9, which we conjugate with Kelly transform, is exactly from subgroup N. And that produce in the right-hand side the equation for parabolic rotations. We may now trace the orbit of a point which taken to be minus imaginary unit, respective one, under corresponding Möbius transformation. So this is a point minus imaginary unit. This is point in elliptic case, parabolic cases, or hyperbolic cases. Under respective Möbius transformation, this point just make the trace, the orbit, which is a boundary of our corresponding unit disk. So we have the equation for the unimodular complex numbers, and then we have an equation in the second line for the hyperbolic numbers with Minkowski metric equal to 1. And then for parabolic situation in equation 10, we get the formula which represent the boundary of this parabolic unit disk. So it's boundary for that shape. So that again repeated on this picture. So in geometric terms, we obtain such type of rotations, which is really helpful for our consideration. But now our purpose is to use this transformation to construct linear representation of SL2R group using the inductive procedure. And the difference between elliptic hyperbolic cases with parabolic one is what rotation in elliptic and hyperbolic was given by diagonal matrices, and these diagonal matrices reduced just to multiplication with certain numbers, Möbius transformation reduced to multiplication, which is a linear operation. However, as we have seen on the previous slide in equation 10, rotation in the parabolic case is really a Möbius transformation, not a simply a multiplication. It is not linear. However, we may try to look, we may try to change our definition in such a way that new parabolic rotation will act as a linear transformation on corresponding on suitable algebraic structure. So this is rather standard situation in mathematics when we have a simple situation, say with complex numbers, where we have one definition and a lot of theorems which state equivalent properties or equivalent description for this definition, which given as a theorem. And when we are going to make a generalization to other situation, we have to choose what definition to apply. And it may be not original definition in the complex play, which was used in the complex case, but it will be rather one of the equivalent statement stated as theorems. So this is what I usually describe as turning theorem into definitions. So again, coming back to our pictures with the rotation, what happened in the elliptic case when we have elliptic rotations, when orbits under such rotation, because this is unitary rotation, contain the numbers with the same modulus. So we may use with, and the same rule happen with the hyperbolic situation. Again, modulus is the same. So we may apply that property to give a definition of another modulus in parabolic situation. I recall what if we use the formula when we multiply a parabolic hypercomplex number with its conjugated, we obtain just square of the first component and second component disappear and so from the modulus. But we may define modulus to be a quantity which is invariant under rotation. So this is contour curves for the modulus with parabolas, which appears on the picture. And a corresponding modulus of parabolic number will be U squared divided by V plus 1, which now contain the second component. When under rotation in elliptic case, so when we rotate here our circle, we have these green lines which correspond points with the equal argument. When we are doing rotation, we just increase argument of all numbers by a fixed amount. Similarly, there are green straight lines here in the hyperbolic case, they also correspond to points with the same argument. So looking on our parabolic rotation, we may spot what only straight lines which are transformed to straight lines here will be the vertical lines, that special lines of parabolic geometry, again shown in green. So we may say what they are representing points with the same value of argument. So that gives a definition at the line 12. Here, what argument of hypercomplex number is 1 over U. Then, what will be the multiplication of the corresponding hypercomplex number in term of modulus and argument? We use the standard formulas. What when we multiply two parabolic numbers, where arguments are multiplied and where moduluses are multiplied and arguments are added, and that formula indeed produces commutative associative operation on a set of parabolic or dual numbers. So definition in term of that argument and modulus. That is relatively easy to define, so it's rather straightforward and in good correspondence to the complex numbers. But we also want to have, besides of multiplication, operation of addition of dual numbers, not usual addition, which is not preserved by or not, which is not invariant under such parabolic rotation, but a sum addition, which together with already defined multiplication produce a good algebraic structure. There are several possibilities how to do that. One interesting possibility is come from the so-called tropical form, tropical mathematics, or it's also known as Maslow dequantization. And the rule for addition really appears from the following observation. You may define the algebraic structure on the collection of real numbers and infinity by the rule what A cross B in circle to separate it from usual multiplication will be the sum of these numbers. And in order to have multiplicative corresponding addition of two numbers A plus B, you choose the operation of minimum among A and B. Then, just a simple calculation, check what this indeed the rules which form commutative associative one-dimensional algebraic structure on reals, and here infinity play the role of zero with respect to such an addition. Clearly, if we add A to infinity, that will be minimum of A and infinity. This is A. So A infinity here is added to serve as a zero to such addition. Again, this is very interesting area of mathematics. In fact, it's turned out what with this algebraic structure, so corresponding algebraic structure is known as R min. There is a similar definition for R max, where you use addition based on maximum of two numbers, and corresponding zero will be minus infinity. Minus infinity need to be added to real numbers to make algebraic structure. So there is very interesting mathematics with a lot of applications, and it's to geometry, to algebra, to quantum mechanics. So it's indeed allow us to use dequantization procedure. So having some quantum structure on real numbers, dequantization will lead to wet R-mean algebra. And there are current seminars running in the UK several times per year. We are gathering to discuss various aspects of this tropical mathematics. So why it's called tropical, by the way, it's just because one of the first big school of this type of mathematics was in Brazil. So for the rest of the world, so it was tropical mathematics then. So, but nowadays, I think there are researchers working in that area around the world. So it's not only in sunny Brazil happen. Okay, so this is one of the possibilities. And if we will add similar structure based on the minimal and maximal algebras respective to lexicographic order on R2, we indeed have a similar good algebra, associative commutative algebra with dual numbers, with another multiplication. Unfortunately, I did not make much research towards that direction. I did not write down corresponding representation, other things, so it's probably still waiting for corresponding work to be done. Rather, we will consider a different definition. we will say what when we are adding two dual numbers in the, that rotation invariant manner in term of the modulus and argument addition will be given by the following formulas. So does it look natural? And my answer would be yes, and I will try to explain why. Say a look on the identity 15, which says what the absolute value of a sum is equal to the sum of absolute values. This is exactly middle position of parabolic case between elliptic one. In elliptic case, we have the triangle inequality, which tell us what the absolute value of the sum is less than sum of absolute values, and that follow from the convexity of unit circle. So triangle inequality follow from convexity of unit circle. In the hyperbolic case, we have opposite inequality because a hyperbolic unit circle is not convex in index. So triangle inequality in hyperbolic case is just opposite. The absolute value of the sum always not less, maybe greater than the absolute value of than the sum of absolute values. So for parabolic situation, we just choose the middle position in between two elliptic and parabolic inequalities. So, and that is identity. So in this sense, parabolic identity 15 is natural. Why the first rule is more or less natural? That is just again based on the geometrical ideas. So if you have addition of two complex numbers and they have different arguments, then for the sum, argument will be closer. So argument of the sum will be closer to the argument of the longest vector. So it's from parallelogram identity. You can see that is to be a common situation. So identity 14 here try to represent a similar situation when the bigger vector contribute more to the argument of the sum. So that formula is just try to replace that common property for complex numbers. So that formulas are really quite meaningful. And good news is what with the rule of addition and multiplication of dual numbers, we indeed get a commutative and associative algebra with distributive law, and that both addition and multiplication are rotationally invariant. So again, some verification may be not very pleasant, in particular if you try to check distributive law based on that rules with moduluses and arguments, but then fortunately can be done with the help of computer algebra systems, so we may rely on computers doing that arithmetics for us, symbolic arithmetic for us. So that is a possibility to define more geometric characters in parabolic situation, which represent this situation. And then the, one of the explanation why with a special addition and multiplication are really working is what by means of birational geometry, this is another significant part of current research in more general setup, of course, when you are applying certain birational transformation of coordinates on manifolds to obtain new geometrical structure. So by means of a birational transformation, which is given on this slide, we are able to reduce our multiplication and addition considered before on algebraic structure to usual addition and multiplication of dual numbers. So in term of that linear algebra, if we introduce basic vectors 1, 0 and minus 1, 0, we are linearly independent in term of this addition and multiplication, which we introduced before, when any other vector can be represented in term of vector UV can be represented in term of these basic vectors, and in term of that coordinates, multiplication turned to be just usual multiplication in coordinates AB, multiplication became just usual multiplication of dual numbers. Really, this is not very surprising because there is a general algebraic statement which tells us what any commutative associative algebra over reals is isomorphic either to complex, dual, or double numbers. So eventually we was succeeded to introduce two-dimensional algebra structure on dual numbers. Under certain isomorphism, it shall be reduced to original multiplication, algebraic multiplication, which we discussed earlier for dual numbers. And with such transformation. So good property of our transformation, isomorphism to dual numbers, what is birational. So it's really connected with the structure of Möbius transformations. So now let us, after discussion of characters, both algebraic and geometric, turn to construction of representations. So we may again start from the subgroup F of upper triangular matrices or lower triangular matrices in our case, and recall what we considered the action, the corresponding homogeneous space which we studied in geometry part of the course was the real line, and action of a SL2A group on the real line was reduced to Möbius transformation given here. And when we now, so that was studied in the geometry, now we are interested in the remainder which we have. Again, I symbolically wrote the previous representation of the group G as the homogeneous space G over H times H. So that was homogeneous space, and that was the subject of our geometry. Now we are adding the part corresponding to subgroup H. So that representation was really in term of group G was SPG, this is what part from the homogeneous space, times certain remainder of G, which would be from subgroup H. So now that part R of G plays a role because we will use it for our linear representation. So calculation is done in the second displayed formula. When we evaluate that part, it became such lower triangular matrix, and we need to take a character from this lower triangular matrix. Again, it's known what a character for this lower triangular matrix will be, just a power, certain power of this diagonal element. So power of diagonal element. So combining all together elements from induced representation formula, we have the last line here, which give explicit expression for our linear representation. So argument of a function f is transformed by linear fractional Möbius transformation. So argument transferred according to the geometrical rule. And we multiply the range. So coming back to our symbolic diagram, that acts on domain of function, and subgroup H act on the range of function. So by multiplication, for example. So we multiply value of the function by the character of the remainder R of G, which is that formula. So if you had if you have seen action of Möbius transformation in complex analysis, you recognize what we obtain certain classical representation of a cell to R group on the real line in that case. Now we make an observation for the Wavelet transforms, which we discussed before. So previously, when we spoke about Wavelet transform, we said what in the case of AX plus B group, we applied representation of our group to some vector which called mother Wavelet, and then make inner product with respect to scalar, make inner product of given function with all possible translation or transformations of the mother Wavelets, which called Wavelets. Now we may meet a situation where mother Wavelet has certain simple transformation properties, which are shown in our first identity, displayed identity here. What if we apply our representation for certain subgroup H tilde, which may be different from subgroup H, which we used to induce our representation, then vector V naught will be eigenvector for that action. So that may happen. And in this situation, Wavelet transform, which we may define in very general situation, really is simplified. So what happened? What we are able to predict how Wavelet transform will behave under right shift by element H from subgroup H, regardless of a signal f which we are analyzing. Really, for any signal f, the right translation by H reduced to multiplication with the character. And in this situation, just as in the geometry, now if we have such a decomposition for subgroup H, the similar structure may be applied for subgroup H tilde, and then it tells us what resulting Wavelet transform is really a function on the homogeneous space corresponding to subgroup H tilde. So it's G over H tilde, where we only need to know value of our Wavelet transform in order to recover entire function, entire Wavelet transform. And that means what Wavelet transform define the function, or it's sufficient to know our function just on corresponding homogeneous space. We define it by subgroup H tilde, which may be different from initial subgroup H. So this is one observation. In order to analyze eigenvectors, which are necessary for induced Wavelet transform, it will be convenient to take infinitesimal version. So again, before we ask the identity what row H act on the vector V naught by the multiplication with a character on that function, rather than taking H from our group G, we may treat H as generated by certain vector X from the Lie algebra, from the Lie algebra of group G, and consider a respective differential equation. So Lie algebra of SL to R, as we already discussed, is consist of traceless matrices. That is three-dimensional vector space. There are different possibilities to choose bases, but one of the most oftenly chosen bases of this Lie algebra is vectors A, B, Z presented on the screen with the following commutators relation among them. And as you can note, it's always one of the advantage of one of the feature of this basis, what whenever you take commutator of two elements of the basis, the commutator is exactly the third element of this basis with some factor. And then for our representation, we may use so-called derived form, which produce representation of corresponding elements of the Lie algebra. So the rule is given in the last displayed formula 17. We pick up element Y from SL to R. We make element of the group by exponentiation with parameter T. Then for this element of the group, we may apply our representation rho. Then for that function, which depend on T, we calculate derivative with respect to T and substitute T equal to zero. So left-hand side and right-hand side of that expression at the end are independent of T. They depend only on Y. So we get certain operator, probably or likely it's unbounded operator, which depend only from element of SL to, well, it's not only for that group in the algebra SL2, it's for any group, can Lie group can be defined in this way, but we are working in only such setting. So we can define representation for our basic vectors. Here is an example of calculations, how to evaluate the derived representation, say from element A, and the representation on the real line, which was derived from affine group before. So we already built with representation on one of the previous slides. Now take with element A, exponentiation produces diagonal matrix. So if we substitute values of this matrix to this formula, we get the expression in the middle of displayed formula. We differentiate with respect to t, and when substitute t equal to zero, so representation will be identity times minus kappa over 2 minus u times derivative operator. So this is derived representation for element A. Similarly, we may evaluate a derived representation for two other elements of the basis. And eventually, if you know action, or if you know your derived representation on elements of the basis, you can calculate it on any other vector simply by the rule of linear algebra. So whenever you take any other element of linear algebra, you decompose it over the given basis, know when the coefficient in the decomposition, and make a linear combination of the right-hand side of equation 18-20 with this coefficient, you will get a vector field which represent the derived representation for the Lie algebra. This is how we calculate them. Now, what would follow? What there is a connection between invariant field and derived representation, and that allow us to use or derive the structure of Cauchy-Riemann equation out of derived representation for SL2R. So assume our mother wavelet is a null solution for certain derived representation which is given or obtained from the representation of the group, then if we are building the corresponding wavelet transform, then the image of this wavelet transform will be null solution of the corresponding invariant fields which are lead derivative on the group G. So that is just a consequence of definition for the Wavelet transform. It's easy to derive from that. Let's look for the form of this general result, which true not only for SL2R but for any Lie group, in term of particular calculation which we done before. So if you will came back to the expression for the derived representation which we calculated here, then it will be easy to verify that the Cauchy kernel on the real line, so this is a function x, well, in term of our variable u, it's 1 over u plus imaginary unit I, will be the null solution of the derived representation of EA plus B. So if you apply it to the function u plus I, you will get a zero. That means what after the Wavelet transform with given a function, that image will be null solution of certain differential operator on the group itself. And calculation shows what that operator which we obtain is exactly Cauchy-Riemann operator on the upper half plane. And correspondingly, Laplacian which is the product of Cauchy-Riemann operator with its complex conjugated, will be again the solution, will be again annihilate our image of Wavelet transform. So that is the background, or this is a reason why if we apply the Cauchy integral formula, which is really the Wavelet transform under discussed representation on the real line, you obtain analytic functions. We will speak about other components of complex analysis in terms of group representation on the next lecture. Do you have any questions? Okay, hope you to see next week.